listen and see if some new insights through the Holy Spirit might come to us on this, the Lord's Day. Peter came up to Jesus and said to him, "Lord, how often shall my brother or sister sin against me and I forgive them? As many as 7 times. Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you 7 times, but 70 times 7. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began the reckoning, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, 'Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay you back everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But that same servant, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, said, 'Pay what you owe.' So his fellow servant fell down and besought him, 'Have patience with me and I will pay you.' He refused and went and put him in prison till he should pay his debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you besought me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I have had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord delivered him to the jailers till he should pay all his debt. So also, my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from the heart." This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Forgiveness. Love, compassion are the top 3 aspects of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God, this will be one of many sermons in what I hope will be a long career about forgiveness. It's an inexhaustible attribute. From my own anecdotal history, I will tell you about my best friend in junior high and high school, whose name was Tom. That is his real name. If he screams and tries to sue me, I guess I could claim it was another Tom, but his name was Tom. He had glasses that were very thick. We often refer to these as like Coke bottle glasses, very thick glasses. He was one of the brightest human beings I have ever known. All A's, correcting the teacher. This guy was brilliant. But as you may remember, if you went to junior high and high school in the 60s, not particularly something that made you popular. This poor chap got beaten up and bullied and ridiculed and teased. It was an awful experience. you stayed in town and you appeared in his courtroom and you were one of those who had bullied him or made fun of him, his sentences were the maximum. You could see the smile and the smirk on his face as he pronounced sentence on these bullies. You know, that might be a cautionary tale for bullies today. You know, we have a big crisis in our country about bullies and people who are bullying. Well, this could be a cautionary tale. Be careful about who you bully, because it could end up being the traffic cop who pulls you over some hapless morning. Well, the reason I mention Tom is because he could not and he did not forgive those kids in junior high and senior high. And as a result, this defined him. He became defined as the vengeful, hanging judge. That's the awfulness of not having a forgiving spirit. C.S. Lewis that being non-forgiving and vengeful, holding a grudge, is like drinking poison in order to hurt someone else. Ultimately, when we don't forgive, we are defined by that, we are poisoned. And in fact, Elder Simmons pointed out to me yesterday this thing that's really disturbing. If you don't forgive, if I don't forgive, God is going to torture us. Well, I have to clean that up a little bit. I don't think God tortures anyone. I think we torture ourselves by being non-forgiving. Just like C.S. Lewis, as you can tell, one of my heroes, once said that God does not punish you and I for our sins. Our sins punish us. Lord is not someone with a white beard and a clipboard who watches over me, and when I do something wrong, I get zapped, I get stricken. If that was our God, not many of us would be walking around, I think. But it is our sins which cause us to be tortured. It is our unforgiving spirit that causes us to define ourselves and be tortured. The message in the gospel is very clear. This is one of many texts. Jesus says, take the plank out of your eye before you point to the speck in someone else's eye. He also tells us when that fallen woman anoints him with expensive oil, that to she who is forgiven much will the capacity come to forgive others. This might be part of the problem. This is what I call the good son syndrome. If you grew up in the church and you never stole anything and you never committed adultery and you never were bad to somebody else and you always followed the rules and you grow up as a perfect Christian, those are the people who have the most trouble with forgiveness and having mutual tolerance, forbearance for other people. It's always been kind of a gift that the Lord gave me, because I went to college in the 60s and early 70s. This man who stands before you is one of the best sinners you'll ever go to meet. St. Augustine was that way. He was a reprobate. He was a womanizer, a drinker. Heck, he grew up in the last part of the Roman Empire. He was really a hedonistic guy. And as a result, he was able to forgive much. He was able to be a forgiving spirit. He was able to be a great saint. I'm here to tell you, if you come into my office with anything that you've done, with anything that you've said, with any infraction or sin, God has created me in a way that I can't possibly judge you, because I've probably done worse things than what you come into my office to talk about. So it's a little easier for us who have been forgiven much to forgive much. And those of us who have done a lot of clean living, as they say, will have difficulty with this. Oh, and that's not the end of the story. Not only am I supposed to forgive, and are you supposed to forgive, but it's from your heart. It means I can't just go through the motions. I can't just say the right words. Those of you who have raised children know about this. Our boys get into a wrestling match and fight and scream at each other, and they hate each other, and we say, "Tell your brother you're sorry." "I'm sorry." "Now tell your brother that you forgive him."
"I forgive you."
Sorry, that's not from the heart. I think when all is said and done, the spirit of forgiveness is a gift that the Lord God, Jesus Christ, gives us. Don't try to do it on your own. If you've had a husband who was wretched to you and you divorced him, if you have a wife who was wretched to you, if you've had people in your junior, senior high class who were mean to you and bullied you, you can't get there on your own. By golly, I'm just going to work harder at forgiving. Believe me, I've tried it. Working on forgiveness is not very effective. This is a supernatural strength and a supernatural power that comes only from God. That may be some bad news, but it's also the good news. Paul would say, "I no longer live, only Christ that lives within me." You remember when the disciples were given their power to cast out demons and to heal the sick? He sent them off. Here was a little boy with a demon that they could not cast out. The first thing Jesus said to them was, "O ye of little faith." Those words from Jesus come to me most of the times when I pray, by the way. "O ye of little faith." We start there. And then he goes on to say, this demon only be cast out. Now, one of the problems with forgiveness is that I can't often perceive the unforgiven places in my own heart. And I need close friends, disciples, who will help me with that. That's Diane. If I'll start harping about somebody and then I harp the next day and I harp the day after that, Diane will say, well, doesn't sound like you've exactly forgiven that person, does it? Well, yes, I have. I just need to talk about it. No, that's not forgiveness from the heart. We need brothers and sisters who will remind us. I often joke with people who harp to me about someone that they have not forgiven or someone that they're angry at. I'll say, oh, I hear this, and it sounds to me like you've gotten over it and it's not an issue anymore. Well, obviously my tongue is embedded in my cheek and I'm saying that this is very much an issue for you. Oswald Chambers even cuts into this even better in one of his devotions. He says, the Lord has an uncanny way of sending you people who are a mirror image of yourself. I hate that. In fact, the gospel is very, very disturbing. It's controversial. You mean, Lord, not only do I have to forgive that person who nearly drove me out of town in one of my former churches, but I have to forgive her from my heart? Yes, Michael, from the heart. But fret not. Fear not. I'm here. I have supernatural powers that I will imbue you with that you can forgive if you'll lean on me, if you'll pray to me, if you'll consider forgiveness as one of our full-time jobs in this life. Count this as sermon number one on forgiveness. Read the scripture. Pray about people that you have forgiven. See what we can do this week and the weeks to come of forgiving folks from our hearts that we only find poison. Thanks be to God for this gospel.